Hi, my name is Sven, welcome back to the channel. So today we're doing something a little bit different. We are following up on testing our LUTs and testing how clean our grades are, but for that we are not going to use any of the test patterns in Resolve or any third-party images. We will use a tool that I built over the last couple of weeks that does all of that. So let me introduce you my new DCTL, the NOIR Generator, and spoiler alert, it's free. Short disclaimer, you need the studio version of Resolve for DCTLs to work, but with the free version you can at least try them out, but you will get a watermark. So what does it do? This utility tool contains a selection of test patterns that we need in everyday life. Many of them are available in Resolve by default, just like this grayscale ramp, but they are a bit complicated to generate, and we saw that in the last video, we have to create them in the edit page, make it a compound clip. Sometimes we have to import them as a TIFF or a PNG, so that's always a bit of a mess, and it's just easier with a DCTL. And some of the test patterns are patterns that I came up with just because I found them really useful and I use them in everyday life anyway. So let's go through them real quick and also talk about what all of those sliders do. So the first one, as we can see, is this grayscale ramp. It just outputs the values from 0 to 1 from left to right, and we can see this in the waveform as a straight line. And here under type it is called the X ramp because it's going from left to right. And we can switch this over to Y ramp and then it goes from bottom to top. The third one is called X times Y ramp because it's basically just a combination of the two. This one is helpful because it focuses a little bit more on the shadow area and we can see maybe some banding or some other artifacts in the blacks a bit better with this one. The next one is called 4-color gradient, and we know that from the Resolve generators as well. It shows us basically all of our primaries and it shows us smooth color gradients, and if we apply a LUT to it, for example, we can definitely see where the LUT breaks, so this is quite useful. The next one is called vector boundaries, and this one gives us a ramp and three different intensities for each primary color, and this one comes especially handy if we look at the vector scope. So as you can see in the vector scope, we get all of our primary colors and it shows us the 100% intensity, the 75% target, and the 50% target. Next one is called ramp and patch, and this one again has just this grayscale ramp, but it also has a solid color patch, and this one is adjustable with the slider with the percentages because we can output 0%, 18% gray, 50% gray, and 100% white, and we can see this reflected in the waveform as well. The next one is the frequency ramp, and this one shows us low frequencies on the left side and high frequencies on the right side. The great benefit of this is when we analyze blurs or other spatial tools like grain or halation, we can actually see the effect of those tools on the frequency content and on the texture with this ramp. And with this ramp we have the frequency contrast slider where we can adjust the contrast of this patch, because on full intensity it might be a little bit too harsh on the eyes, but if we need to boost it or lower it, we can just do this with the slider. And the next one is called cube, and this one is really helpful, especially in combination with the vector scope, because as you can see, it covers all the colors there are in different brightness intensities and saturation intensities. And also we can actually adjust the resolution of this patch with the cube size slider. So if we lower this number, we get bigger patches and we can see where LUTs break, for example, but we lose a bit of resolution in the vector scope, so we can increase this number to get more resolution in the vector scope if we want to. And the last one is called hue ramp, and this one is also really helpful in combination with the vector scope because again we can see all the primary colors and all the colors in between, but also in the viewer we see the smooth gradients and we can definitely see where LUTs will break, for example. So now let's look at this checkbox called stepped ramp. If we click this, we can see that now our gradient has some steps, and we can actually adjust the resolution of those with the number of steps slider. And this might again be really useful when we are looking at LUTs. And with the pre and post gamma, we can shift the focus towards either the shadows or the highlights of the stepped ramp. Now if we enable stepped ramp, this will not only affect the X ramp, but also the Y ramp. So now we can see all those horizontal lines in the waveform. It affects the X times Y ramp. It affects the ramp and patch, and it also affects the hue ramp. And now if we look at the vector scope, now you can actually see distinct reference points, and if we apply a LUT, we can actually see how the LUT moved those points and how it distorted the colors to this new color palette. Let's actually look at this LUT with the other test patterns as well. So for example, with the cube, we can really see how this LUT moved all of the colors towards the center. It really desaturated especially the blues and greens and magentas, but it keeps a lot of the red intensity and it doesn't affect the skin tones too much. Now with the X-Ramp, we can see the effect on the contrast that this LUT has. So we have this really smooth S-curve, but the highlights are being brought down quite a lot. And if we enable stepped ramp, we can see this really smooth compression in the highlights and in the shadows. Now let's also look at this LUT with the 4-color gradient. So without the LUT, the vector scope looks like this. And with the LUT, it looks like this. Again, we can see really smooth curves and really smooth roll-offs. And in the viewer, we don't see any harsh edges or any color gradients breaking with this LUT. But for example, with this LUT that we looked at in the last video, we can really see where the color gradients break. So now this is the LUT applied on the hue ramp, so obviously we don't have any color other than orange and teal. We have all of those harsh edges and those artifacts, and also the blues are getting really dark. So now let's look at the good LUT again. As you can see, we still have a little bit of green, we have some magenta and some cyan and blue. We don't totally strip away all of those colors, but we have a lot of smooth gradients, and this is how a LUT should look on those test patterns actually. Now one more tip, if we use the hue ramp in stepped ramp mode and we apply a vertical blur, all of our reference point in the vectorscope now turned into lines. So this is how the vectorscope looks with the LUT applied now. So now let's look at the frequency ramp and some texture operations. In this node I have applied the texture pop and the blur and a little bit of midtone detail. And we can now see when I enable this node how this graph suddenly changes. So as you can see, we are boosting a little bit of the lower frequencies and we are dampening some of the higher frequencies. So this is what a blur does to the texture of the image. It gets rid of all of the high frequencies, but so far it doesn't really affect the low frequencies. So the great benefit of using a DCTL is that we can place it anywhere in the node tree. So here for example, we have a really simple color grade with basic color management going from Arri White Gamut to DaVinci White Gamut, and in the end from DaVinci White Gamut to Rec 709. Then we have some exposure and white balance adjustments, a really simple vignette and a LUT. So if we only want to see the LUT or any other color adjustments but we don't want to see the exposure and the vignette, we can just simply plug in the DCTL after that, like this. And the reason I'm using two nodes here is because the generator first of all just outputs patches or values, and we could interpret them as Rec 709 and therefore we have to convert to our working color space with a CST afterwards. And I purposely didn't build any color management into the generator because first of all, that's just way too complex for a generator. Secondly, it really depends on which color management system you are working at. So in ASUS for example, you need totally different transforms and you're just way more flexible if you just add a second node after that. And sometimes you don't want any color space transform after that. It's just a generator, it just outputs certain patches, and sometimes it's more useful to apply a color space transform after that, and sometimes it's more useful to not apply a color space transform after that. So for example, with patterns like the cube, it might be a good idea to add a CST after that. As you can see here, we're getting a lot of clipping and oversaturated colors, but this is not due to the LUT, this is just because we are adding this color space transform at the very end that's going from DaVinci White Gamut to Rec 709. As you can see, this is just the color space transform applied on the cube pattern. So if we just convert our test pattern to DaVinci White Gamut, now we can see the exact behavior of the LUT in this color space. So again, it really depends on what you want to do. Sometimes you need to apply a color space transform after that, and sometimes it's better to not do that. It's totally up to you what you want to do with that. So if you're using the ramp and patch for example, and you're working color managed, you can just simply right click on the node and set it to linear, because this way the patch outputs values in the linear color space. So if it's set to 18%, it shows you middle gray. But you could also do this with a color space transform in a second node after that. So for example, with the vector boundaries pattern, it is maybe a better idea to apply a color space transform to our working color space as well. So if you enjoyed this tool, you can get it for free on my website. The link is down below in the video description. And as I said, the really cool thing about this is that you can just put it anywhere in the node tree without having to browse a library first or having to create a compound clip beforehand. It's just one of those tools that I want to see everybody use, so please share this video with a friend, leave a comment and a like on this video, and if you're new here, consider subscribing to the channel because it really helps out. And yeah, I will see you again in the next episode.